Hey guys, so today I thought I'd do another interesting video, and I'm going to be touching on military myths, as I call it. I'm going to basically expose them or debunk them, and I'm anxious to see what you guys think, what your comments and feedback are going to be. But there's just some things that have been going on for years, random rumors or assumptions having to do with military history, military collecting, different things, and unfortunately, they're just not true. I mean, and it'll make more sense here as the video goes on. I'll probably be doing a part two, maybe later on a part three of this. But for right now, I've got five different myths that I'm going to touch on in this video and debunk. And so I hope you'll watch the whole video. I believe you're really going to enjoy it a lot. And so I'm going to get started. Now, in I believe it was 1962, I know in the 1960s, there was a movie called The Longest Day that came out. It's got John Wayne, a lot of celebrities, actors, actresses, and everything. It was a masterpiece. And basically, most of you have seen Saving Private Ryan, which this is from the 60s, so it's not as graphic and everything as Saving Private Ryan was, but it's still about D-Day, right? And there's a scene having to do with this gadget right here. This is some people, they would call it a cricket or a clicker, and it has to do in the scene. It has to do with an American paratrooper has one of these, and he thinks he gets a response from another American soldier, and he comes out of his hiding and he ends up getting killed. And I'm gonna insert a couple clips from that video, from that movie. One of them is John Wayne's character, which was I think it's Colonel Vandervert, if I'm not mistaken. And he basically touches on this gadget right here. And then there's actually, I'm going to insert the scene from the movie having to do where the paratrooper, interacted with using this, and come to find out it was an enemy soldier. And then also, I'm going to do it myself. I'm going to use this, and I'm going to compare it to the action on my Mauser. I don't want to ruin it for those of you who are unfamiliar with what I'm talking about, so y'all go ahead and watch these clips, and I'll get back to you.
I heard. At ease. Well, you're as ready as we can make you. This 5-cent toy wasn't issued to you for laughs. May save your life. You're gonna be landing in the dark. And on the other side of that hedgerow, a fellow may not be wearing the same uniform you are. So, one click is to be answered by two clicks. And if you don't get that answering click, hit the dirt, open fire. I repeat, one click must be answered by two clicks. Now hang on to this gimmick. It's as important as your weapon. Do you read me?
Loud and clear, sir.
All right. One more thing. Your assignment tonight is strategic. You can't give the enemy a break. Send them to hell.
Alright, so as you just saw in that clip, the American paratrooper had one of these clickers here, and he clicked once, and he listened, and he heard two clicks in response, right? But what he didn't know, unfortunately, was it was a German soldier using his Mauser action to replicate the two clicks. And so I'm going to demonstrate this for you, and let's compare the two sounds. Got the one, and there's the response you would listen for. Now here's a German K98 Mauser, and we're going to see what the action sounds like on it compared to the clicker. What'd you think? Let's do it one more time. So
So like I said, the American paratrooper would have gone, there's the one, there's the two, here's the German action. So what do you think? Does it sound alike or not? Or is it just some Hollywood that was added in the movie? Let me know what you think.
All right, so let me know what you thought about that. I'd love to hear your comments and see what you have to say, see what your opinions are and everything. Moving on here, I'm going to touch on this right here, the dog tag. And I'm actually going to turn the video around and go over this notch in the dog tag right here. And I'm going to debunk the myth going along with why the dog tag has a notch in it. So I'm going to bring you in now. Alright, so now I'm going to touch on the dog tag, especially the older dog tags who have the notch, right? Now, there's a myth going around, trying to get my notes here, bear with me. Alright, there's a myth going around that these dog tags with a notch, that the notch is in place because it was used to, like when a soldier was deceased, they would stick this in the front teeth and then they would kick it to basically lock it in between their middle front teeth to hold it in place so that the dog tag never leaves the body. You know, and that's just stupid. That's not true. I'm not going to say it didn't ever happen, but as a whole, you know, that's not what this notch was for. That's not why it's in the dog tag at all. What it is, this notch, when this was a blank tag, this notch was held in place. That's how the tag, the blank, was held in place so that the soldier's information could be engraved or embossed into the tag. You know, the name, serial number, shot date, or shot year, and blood type, and religion, all that kind of stuff. That's what the notch is for. It is not for kicking this in a soldier's teeth. Like I said, I'm not going to say it didn't ever happen. I'm sure it probably did happen. But as a whole, it was not original practice. So that's why the notch is in there. And I mean, I know war is cruel and everything, but if I was an American soldier and one of my buddies died, or even fellow countrymen, fellow U.S. soldiers died, there is no way that even if this was a practice, even if this was the reason for this notch, that I could put this in their mouth and kick them in the mouth, or I couldn't just kick a dead body in the face, you know. That's just, to me, that's just morbid and cruel. You know, I know war is cruel and more. I know it is, but I just couldn't do that. I couldn't kick a fellow American soldier in the face, in the mouth, to do this. I'd have to do something differently with the dog tag. If that was the common practice, I'd just be like, you know what, I can't do that, so I'm going to do something different to make sure this dog tag stays with the body. I mean, doesn't that just sound stupid to you guys, to think that soldiers would kick their fellow soldier, you know, fellow their buddy in the mouth? That's just dumb. And like I said, that's not what it's for. It had to do with the machine. The blank was put into when it was engraved. That's what the notch is for. That's what it is. So if anybody says, you know, it's kicking them in the teeth, I mean, I'm not going to get in an argument with somebody. I'll just let them keep thinking, we know, whatever. But I mean, I might correct them in a nice way, but a lot of people want to fight and argue because they've heard the same thing for 900 years, but when really they've heard lies and myths for 900 years. Moving on here to the next myth, I've got a bayonet here. It's a Type 30 Japanese Arisaka bayonet. I'm going to use it for, you know, just for this video. And it's not just bayonets, but, you know, knives, all blades. You know, a lot of them, you'll see this groove here, right? And it's a myth that is called a blood groove, and that's a bunch of crap. That is not true. It is not a blood groove. That's not what it is for. What it is, it's called a fuller. And what it did, it basically was a way of lightening the blade, making the blade lighter without sacrificing length. And it also helped with the balance of the blade. So, you know, and I'm not going to say if somebody didn't get stabbed with this or a knife or whatever, blood wouldn't get on the blade. Of course it would, but this is not a blood groove for blood to ooze out on. That's just stupid. It's not true. That's not, it's a myth. That's not what it's for. It's a fuller. It is a fuller to make it lighter without sacrificing length, to make it balanced. That's what it is. So if anybody says, hey, that's got a blood groove on it, then I'm not being mean, but, you know, they're wrong. They're mistaken. You know, that's just what it is. And so, I mean, you know, try not to be hard, but I mean, that's what it is. So you got a fuller and not a blood groove. So that's another one there. So let's keep going. All right, myth number three. Is that right, or is it four? Anyways, myth number four is the N-block clip, and really the M1 grain. I don't have mine here, but I'll insert a clip of me shooting mine. You can hear the ping, which there's thousands of videos of ping videos on YouTube. But now there's a myth going around that enemy soldiers, Germans, Japanese, whatever, that they would wait until they could hear the ping after the eighth round, and then they would know, hey, that U.S. soldier or whoever's got to reload. Now's my chance to expose myself and try to, you know, take them out, right? And that's a lie. That's not, it's just a myth. And I'm not going to say it didn't ever happen. I'm sure it did, but as a whole, that's not true. Because you think, in the battle, there's going to be countless guns going off, rifles being shot. There's going to be aircraft dropping bombs. There's going to be tanks firing. There's going to be mortars going off. There's going to be artillery. There's just going to be so much chaos, grenades, mines, voices. There's so much going on. It's just going to be crazy. There's no way that you would be able to hear a ping. I mean, you just won't be able to hear it. Now, that's not to say a soldier wouldn't, an enemy soldier wouldn't see the clip pop up, but, you know, American soldiers were trained to reload fast because, hey, their life was on the line. Their life is at stake. They got to hurry up and get back in the fight. You know, they got to hurry up and reload so that they can start engaging the enemy again. You know what I mean? And so to say that the enemy would wait for the ping, you know, and then they'd start firing, I mean, that's just not true. I'm not going to say it didn't ever happen because out of thousands of skirmishes and firefights that have taken place, I'm not going to say, you know, that didn't ever happen, but, I mean, as a whole, that's just silly. It's just not true. It's a myth, and, I mean, like I said, I'll insert a clip of me shooting my grain and let you hear, but, you know, the enemy could not just wait. It, I mean, it's just not true. It's, a lot of stuff's just not even worth elaborating on that much because it's so silly. Lastly, I want to touch on this rifle right here. This is a number one Mark III Star. It's a World War I British Enfield. It's dated 1917. Now, there's a myth out there that, see, I've got the bolt already taken out, that in, if there was an instance where, you know, British soldiers or whoever might be using this weapon were surrounded by the enemy, there's no hope, they're going to have to be taken prisoner or whatever, there's a myth out there that the soldiers would take the bolt head off here and, I'm going to show you this, and they would insert it into this hole here, right where the bridge is, or the charging bridge, for the stripper clipper charger, and they would break the firing pin off. Now, I want you to know that that is absurd, and that is stupid, because, I mean, I'm not going to say it didn't ever happen, but as a whole, that's not what they did, and this hole here is not for breaking the firing pin off. That's not what it's there for. It that's a way of this piece being held into place, basically, on the machine, you know, on the press or whatever, when this part was being machined or produced, right? It has nothing to do, it's not in there for breaking a firing pin. That's just not true. That's not what it's for, you know? And so I wanted to debunk that. And I mean, and these older infield bolts, they have really long threads, so it would take, you know, several, it would take a decent amount of time to unthread the thing, insert in there and break it. And I mean, that's just stupid when there's other options they could do. I mean, if it was me, I mean, I'd hate to say it, but if I had to, you know, if I was surrounded, going to be captured, I didn't want them to use this weapon against me or my fellow countrymen or whatever, what I would do is I would find a tree or a big rock, and I would bash this thing to pieces. I would make it inoperable. I would destroy this thing, or I would use grenades or something and blow it into pieces, or I would throw it in a river or lake or pond or ocean or whatever. Or, you know, at least throw the bolt away. Whereas if they just damage the bolt, you know, the firing pin, yeah, the bolt's crap, but they could take the rifle and eventually, you know, you find another bolt for it, and hey, it's back in action, right? Used our own weapons, or, you know, the British soldiers' own weapons will be used against them still. It's just stupid to think that they would take the time to unthread it, use this hole here, which is not for a firing pin to be inserted into, and break it off, when there's other options of making this inoperable, this weapon inoperable, you know what I mean? And so I'm going to demonstrate and show you guys real quick how to, you know, about unthreading this and just showing what all would go into doing that. So here we go. All right, so here we go. So this is, you know, an infield bolt. Came out of my number one Mark III. Now look at the threads on this. Look at the time it takes to unthread the bolt head. Watch. Let me show you. Which I'm doing a little bit slower because I want you to realize how long the threads are. Right? So they would do this, supposedly. Right? They would unthread this like this. And see, I'm still going. Look at that. And see, I can't pull it out. It's still in there. Look how long those threads are. So they would just keep doing this. Right? Okay, now there we go. And they would take this right here. See, there's your firing pin sticking out. And they would take their rifle. Let me bring it in. And you see, you got the hole. There we go. They would take the hole. See? See that hole there? And they would do this. They would put their firing pin in there. Can you see it? See, it's stuck down in there. And then they would snap it off and break it. Right? That is not what they did. And again, I'm not going to say they didn't ever do that. But as a whole, that's not what they did. Because, I mean, the German soldier, they could still take the rifle, take the bolt, and just insert another firing pin, and then it's still in use. Or they, if the bolt was crapped out, you know, they could still find a replacement bolt eventually. You know, I mean, it's just stupid. They could just, the soldier who was going to be captured could just destroy the weapon as a whole altogether and be done with it, right? Now, look how long it takes to thread this back on here. I mean, these are really long threads, see? Which I've slowed it down a little bit because I want you guys to see. I don't want to do it real fast. I'm just saying, though, it's just a myth. That hole had to do with the machining process of that part of the receiver, not for inserting a firing pin. But anyways, guys, I'm going to wrap this video up. Thank you guys for all the support and everything. I hope you're liking these different videos I've been doing already starting off this year. I wanted to take a different direction with my channel. I'm still going to do similar videos as before, but I wanted to be, you know, make different videos, make my channel more exciting, informative and everything, and educational, I guess. And I really appreciate all the support and everything, and I'm looking forward to a great year of collecting. I hope to add some great items to my collection, and I hope you guys continue to follow me and everything, and it's going to be a good year. But as always, guys, thank you for watching.